this week on Destinations.
The few soldiers that dared venture into this tree line never returned, fueling the ghost stories that are still around today.
Glass blowing is an art that has been around the Black Forest since the 13th century.
In fact, it's said that a very famous wine originated in this monastery, in this very wine cellar, or wine cabinet, as it's called. Perhaps you've heard of this wine. It's called a Cabernet.
Hi, and welcome to Destinations. I'm your host, Army Sergeant Rob Gwin. And this week on Destinations, we're coming to you from the Aperbaum Monastery near Wiesbaden, Germany. And this monastery is about 800 years old. It has a lot of interesting and unique stories to tell. We're going to walk around the monastery, see some of the sites, and try to find out some of those stories. A little bit later on, we're also going to check in with Army Sergeants Joe Thompson and Stephen Roach, who visited the Black Forest in search of a cuckoo clock. And we'll let them tell us all about that adventure a little bit later on in the show. But right now, why don't we take a walk around the monastery and see some of the sights.
I will remember you. Will you remember me? Don't let your
In the 12th century by monks from the Cistercian order, the Aperbaum Monastery still stands today as a testament to the order's strict minimalist beliefs.
Their strict religious beliefs, the monks who built and first occupied this monastery, they didn't believe in colorful artwork or ornate architecture. In fact, it was their religious belief that these very things distracted them from their religious purposes. And so, the stark gray walls of this cathedral stand today almost exactly like they did when they were first built nearly 800 years ago.
Giant grape presses stand silent now, but are a reminder of the rich winemaking culture of the monastery and this region of Germany.
In addition to their daily prayer and meditation, the monks of the Aperbaum Monastery are famous for making wine. In fact, it's said that a very famous wine originated at this monastery in this very wine cellar, or wine cabinet, as it's called. Perhaps you've heard of this wine. It's called a Cabernet.
Today, visitors to the monastery can sample many of the wines that are still made on the grounds.
Once there was a darkness deepening in this night. Gave me everything you had. Oh, you gave me life.
It can take a full day to enjoy all the sights of the Aperbaum Monastery and Museum, but it's certainly a day well spent.
So when you walk around the Aperbaum Monastery, there is a lot of things to see and do,
thousands of years of history here, and it can sometimes be a little bit overwhelming. So for us, we have Dr. Jens Jakob here with us to tell us just a little bit about the monastery. Dr. Jakob, thank you very much for having us here at the monastery.
You're very welcome.
How old is the monastery?
The monastery is very old, very traditional area here. It was founded in 1136.
By who?
By the Cistercian order. Mm-hmm. The ruler of the Cistercian order in this times was Bernard von Clairvaux, and he was actually the founder of this monastery here, a very famous and a very prominent figure in the medieval history of Europe.
So the Cistercian order, they were the first residents of the monastery?
Yes. The Cistercian order was here, had this residence here up to 1802, 1803, and then there was the so-called secularization, and the secularization took place in order to give the Duke of Nassau some land, some area back, which he lost to France, and they gave him this owner, this by the church owned area here.
So the monks from the Cistercian order, the first residents here, they're a little bit famous for something here.
They are famous for two things. In general, they are famous for their strictly life. The Cistercian order was a reform order, and they said praying, laboring, that's very important for monks, and we will reformize the thinking and the monastery rules. This is what they were famous for. And here in Eberbach, they are very famous for their viniculture. They made very good wines here for more than 700 years, and they were very successful in selling them all over the world. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they were the biggest wine trade company in the world.
Well, I've actually had a chance to sample some of the wine from here, and I can tell you it is very, very tasty. Very good wine here.
I'd like to hear that.
When visitors come to visit the monastery, what are some of the things that you would recommend they absolutely should see or do when they're here?
All the area they should see. But if they have if they have a lack of time, they should visit the cloister and the church, of course. Mm-hmm. The church is totally preserved in the Romanesque style, and you have only seldom the opportunity to see a church which shows that in this purity, let's say.
Mm. Now, I understand that the monastery is also a little bit famous in another regard, that a movie was produced
here. Indeed it was. Indoor shots of Name of the Rose were taken here, nearly all of them.
So when visitors come here, is there still evidence of the movie? Are there still things from the
movie? Yeah, there are some things. We have still a column in the church. Mm-hmm. Every visitor thinks that it's an original column, but actually it's a papmaché. I don't know the English word, papmaché, is it that?
Yeah. Okay, Dr. Jakob, thank you very much for inviting us to the monastery. And we're going to see more of the monastery, so just stay tuned to Destinations.
All soldiers need to go to Primary Leadership Development Course before being promoted to E5. The 7th Army Training Command's website has all the information supervisors and students need to know before going to school. You'll find everything you need to prepare for the stepping stone to your NCO career. There are class schedules, packing lists, phone numbers, and student guides. Check out the 7th ATC's website before heading off to PLDC at www.grafenwehr.army.mil and click on the 7th ATC link.
A financial readiness tip from the 266 Finance Command.
By law, the government travel card must be used by all frequent travelers for official government business.
It should not be used when soldiers PCS or for personal business. Be a responsible traveler. Know what expenses you can bill to your card. Settle your TDY claim immediately and pay your travel card bill as soon as it arrives.
Cardholders, if you need assistance, contact your agency program coordinator.
Welcome back to Destinations. You know, strolling along the walkways of the Eberbach Monastery near Wiesbaden, Germany, well, it's just like stepping back in time. And it's certainly a great place to come and visit for a short day trip on a Saturday afternoon. But maybe you have a little more time to invest, maybe a whole weekend. Well, in that case, Army Sergeants Joe Thompson and Stephen Roach recommend the Black Forest as a location to visit, where they just recently went in search of a cuckoo clock. So why don't we check in with them and see how the search is coming.
Black Forest is ideal for tourism, has long been regarded as the perfect combination of a major cultural legacy and unspoiled natural beauty. Around the 5th century BC, Celtic tribes settled the region. 400 years later, the Romans came and gave the region its name, Silva Nigra. I'm standing in an area known as Hexenlock. Loosely translated, that means the witch's hole. This is one of the deepest and darkest areas of the Black Forest. Its history dates back to a time where legends and folklore say that villagers fled to the Hexenlock for refuge from the Roman soldiers. Now, the soldiers were afraid to enter this area because legend said it was haunted.
The few soldiers that dared venture into this tree line never returned, fueling the ghost stories that are still around today. Well, it's time to go check in with Joe. He's one of the area's best glass blowers.
Although the Black Forest is traditionally known for its cuckoo clocks and cakes, glass blowing also has a history here. I'm at the Dorothy and Junta Glass Factory in Wolfach, where we'll discover the process of making glass. Glass blowing is an art that has been around the Black Forest since the 13th century. The Dorothy and Junta started 52 years ago and is the only glassworks in the region that still practices the rare art of glass blowing. Glass begins as quartz sand, pot ash, and red lead, and is heated to 3600 degrees Fahrenheit. It is gathered from the furnace with a blowing iron. It's then shaped and blown in a wooden mold. Blowing iron constantly rotates to keep the glass shape symmetrical throughout the entire process. It's then handed to another glassmaker, who awaits more fluid glass from a gatherer, which is added to the stem to make the base. The glass is then pinched from the blowing iron and is brought to an oven so that it can be cooled slowly and becomes solidified glass. The final step in creating a glass masterpiece is adding the cuts that creates the design on the piece of glass. Reporting for Destinations, I'm Army Sergeant Joe Thompson.
We'll check back in with Joe and Steve again in just a little bit to see how their search for a cuckoo clock is coming along. But right now, let's take another little short trip, this time to Frankfurt, Germany, with Air Force Sergeant Steve German, where he takes us to a museum that reveals all the tricks to the magic of movie making.
Today we're at the German Film Museum in Frankfurt, Germany, to take a look at the history of the illusion of movie making.
For centuries, people have wanted to create moving pictures and tell stories using those moving pictures. One of the interesting things about seeing moving pictures is that it's all an illusion. Early attempts at creating the illusion of movement are on display inside the museum on the first floor. The displays fool your eyes and brain into thinking that what you're looking at is moving. This is the same concept used in film and television nowadays. The magic lantern was a popular form of entertainment used from the end of the 17th century to project images using light. Another section shows the principle of Thomas Edison's kinetoscope, which uses photographs, each slightly different and viewed in a sequence, giving the optical illusion of movement. From there, the exhibit turns into the golden age of cinema.
The German Film Museum in Frankfurt gives visitors a chance to look back at the history of filmmaking and even has a 1931 box office.
Once the idea of moving pictures caught on, filmmakers found new and creative ways to fool the audience further by developing the concept of special effects.
The museum gives you a chance to take a look and see just how some of the tricks in films are done. Look, Mom, no hands.
The museum takes a hands-on approach to a lot of the displays, and visitors can even take a magic carpet ride. Other items in the permanent exhibit include costumes and makeup used in well-known movies.
Though it's called the German Film Museum, they also showcase some of the more well-known American films, like The Maltese Falcon. Sweetie.
A variety of projectors used during the 1930s to the 50s are also on display, including an entire set piece giving the illusion of being somewhere you're not.
While it's no Planet Hollywood, it does give you a chance to take a step into the movies and see how some of the tricks are done.
The German Film Museum is open Tuesday through Sunday from 10 a.m., except for Saturdays, when the museum opens at 2 in the afternoon. From the German Film Museum in Frankfurt, Germany, Air Force Sergeant Steve German for Destinations.
You know, walking around the Eberbach Monastery and checking out all this history is absolutely amazing. In fact, there are monasteries just like this one all over Europe that you can visit. Air Force Sergeant Gary Piccirillo visited the Monastery of Mount Vergine in Italy, just north of Naples, and tells us more.
In the early 12th century, the legend goes, a young man who lived on Mount Vergine was readying himself for a pilgrimage to the Holy Lands of Palestine. On the dew-covered morning of his departure, the Lord appeared to the young man and directed him not to venture to Palestine, but rather stay in the mountain and practice his faith there. So moved was the man by this vision that he spent his entire life building the Church of the Madonna, later to evolve into the shrine and monastery of Mount Vergine. Hundreds of years after that fateful moment, the monastery has grown, prospered, and remains to this day. Thousands of visitors flock to the shrine each year, which overlooks the small town of Irapina, a virtual thumbnail of a village which sits outside the small city of Avellino, 50 kilometers east of Naples. Getting to the shrine is an adventure in itself. While a narrow mountain road can be traveled,
I was 7 years old when my parents died and I was brought to the monastery to live. Well, I'm 86 now and I've seen so much, two world wars. Most people are too young to remember the Germans fighting up in these mountains, but I do. And I'm one of the only ones left. But even after I'm gone, this mountain will still remain.
Shrine and Monastery of Mount Vergine. Travelers from all over Europe visit the site, each one returning home a little better for the experience.
When you visit the Eberbach Monastery, you have to check out their museum, which has items and artifacts that, of course, catalog the history of this magnificent place. Like this piece here behind me, which is the only surviving original stained glass window pane from the monastery's cathedral, and is over 700 years old. So while I walk around and check out some of the other exhibits here in the museum, why don't you check back in with Army Sergeants Joe Thompson and Stephen Roach to see how their search for a cuckoo clock in the Black Forest is coming along.
Cuckoo clocks are as much a part of the Black Forest as Black Forest cakes. These clocks represent the culture and craftsmanship of this region. They also represent the people and its history.
Cuckoo clocks have a sound all their own.
Tell why you punish me. Black wave crashing into the shore, you wash away my dreams. Time, why you walk away. Like a friend.
The owners here have been making clocks for six generations.
Six generations before make cuckoo clocks. And I've been in the business about here 25 years. And when I be a young boy, I made clock in my father's and uncle's workshop. And by my grandfather, I helping my grandfather before, okay?
The Hare family clockmakers can produce over 40 clocks a day.
Yeah. It's not work for me, really. Yeah. Sometimes, summertime, when we have much business, I work 10 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the night. Nothing for me.
Why you punish me?
Eberbach Monastery is certainly a great place to visit, and it's not too difficult to find. From Frankfurt, it's just a 20-minute drive up Autobahn 66 in the direction of Wiesbaden. Well, that's going to do it for this edition of Destinations, but if you'd like to contact us with questions or comments about our show, or maybe even a possible story idea, just send us an email. That email address is destinations@afn.frankfurt.army.mil. I'm Army Sergeant Rob Gwin, and we'll see you next time on Destinations.